Hey, good morning, everyone. So we're looking at the topic of adsorption. And just to recap what we looked at on Wednesday, we introduced some new terminology. And you were looking this up and researching it as well during class. But let's this can get a little bit messy sometimes. So adsorbate is essentially the solute. And adsorbent so the adsorbent is your MSA that you're adding to the system so that the solutes can preferentially attach to that adsorbent. So I mean, these two words are so similar that you can often mix them up, but I will sometimes just use the word solute to emphasize that I'm talking about the species that we're adsorbing onto the adsorbent. So that's the background terminology, and then we spent some time looking at a few examples. We considered these ideas of moisture being adsorbed onto silica gel. So almost certainly seen one of these little bags inside a box of electronics, a laptop computer, for example. So during shipping that product stays dry. And then we also considered a few other examples last time where we looked at gas purification. This one is particularly interesting, oxygen from nitrogen. We'll see that in an example. And then this case of liquid-liquid separation, so you've got liquid-based products flowing through your adsorber, and one of the compounds are preferentially loading onto the adsorbent. So we ended off at roughly at that point last time, and I said we would look in this class at the adsorbents themselves. Let's understand this material that we're dealing with. So it's a very, very porous material, of course. We said last time that very high surface area per unit mass. So area per unit mass is a critical aspect that we look at when we're purchasing these adsorbents. And to get that very high surface area, the particle is extremely porous. Many pores go right into the internal of the particle. And I've got some adsorbents here at the front that I'll pass around in a minute. But essentially, I mean, you can't see this to the human eye. These pores are in the order of a number of angstrom size. Now we'll look at that in a minute. And the particles the solute that we're interested in has to come from the outside, the bulk, and move to the interior of the adsorbent. So there's several things actually going on there. There's this rate with which it can diffuse internal to the adsorbent, so there's a diffusion in there, and that's limited by kinetics. Okay, there's a time duration that it takes for that to happen. There's a steric effect. So steric is a word that's related to shape or size. So obviously, if these pores are too small, certain molecules, larger molecules, cannot enter them. Or if the molecule is sort of just at that size limit, you can see that it's going to be bouncing around in here. So if that pore is just sort of on the order of magnitude of the molecule itself, that's also going to hinder the speed with which it can move through there. And then there's equilibrium as well. We're going to consider that in a later class. But that solid phase has some sort of surface charge and can interact with the molecule itself. Okay? So there's this equilibrium interaction on that surface there. So several mechanisms are all taking place simultaneously. And it's not that once you put the solute in the presence of the adsorbent that it instantaneously latches on there. There's a finite time that it takes to meet that surface and to stay there. And that's all related to kinetics and equilibrium. So we've got this idea from your thermodynamics, from chemistry, from reactor design, of kinetics, right? Things take some sort of time to occur. When we looked at it in reactor design, we looked at kinetics in the sense that we say the number of moles of product being formed per unit time, per unit mass, okay? So we know that our product takes there's a rate, a reaction rate constant. And if you leave that material there long enough, you'll eventually reach equilibrium. Okay? So we looked at reactions back in 3K from two perspectives. Those that get to equilibrium so quickly, we might as well just use the equilibrium constant for the reaction. And then there's those reactions that take a long time and may never actually reach equilibrium. And for those reactors and those systems, we have to use kinetics. Okay? So here's the same idea here. Once you contact your solute with your adsorbent, it may take some time for this solute to latch onto the surface of the adsorbent for those reasons there. It's not an instantaneous process. And so you'll see that typically the equipment for adsorbers is fairly large, giving it a long residence time to attach to the surface there so that you can load on that solute onto the adsorbent. So let's get an idea of what we're dealing with here in terms of size. We're comfortable with the size range. We're going to be using angstroms. So angstrom, 10 to the 10 angstroms, is just one order of magnitude removed from the nanometer level. So nanometers, 10 to the 9, we're comfortable with. Micrometers, we're comfortable with from an earlier part in this course. So angstroms is just one step away from that. So a hydrogen or a helium atom is in the order of one angstrom. And the pores that we're going to be looking at, the pores on these adsorbents, I might as well pass some of this around right now. So here's activated carbon, the black adsorbent going by. So the pores on these adsorbents are in the order of 10 to 200 angstroms. So you can start to see we're right down at the molecular size. If hydrogen is one angstrom, we're really, really at that small, small size range for the at the molecular level. Now, what's of interest to us is this number over here. What surface area is provided by one pore? So if you consider your pore to be a cylinder of length L with diameter D, you can calculate the volume of that cylinder. And then in your numerator there, you've got the surface area, the internal surface area provided by the cylinder. So that's sort of a very idealized picture. You can get the surface area per unit volume. And so we can see that smaller pore diameters are desirable. As you go to smaller pore diameters, you get a larger surface area for a given volume. What's also of interest is a different number. So let's this is not in the notes. Let's just record this. Is this value SG. Okay. So SG is the area per unit mass. And SG is a quantity we can derive this, but it's, let's just put the formula down here, 4 times a porosity, and I'll define what that porosity is in a minute, times the particle density times the pore diameter. Okay, so EP, or epsilon P, is the particle porosity. Another way of stating that is, what is the void fraction internal to the particle? Okay. So this was, if you looked at the particle, how much of that particle is open space versus how much of that is solid itself. And that number might be sort of in the order of 50%. So this activated carbon going around there, if you looked at one of those particles, half of it is actually open space internally, and half of it is the actual carbon itself, would be a value of EP 50%. Rho P is the particle density. Okay, so let's just use a value of, say, 1,000 kilograms per meter cubed there for that. The porosity, let's just use a value of about 0.5. We're just getting a rough idea of the order of magnitude from this equation. And dP is your pore diameter. Okay. And we said that was in the order of the angstrom range. So let's just use a value of, say, 20 angstroms. Okay, and if you sub those three numbers in there, you'll get an SG in this particular example of 1,000 grams per meter squared. 1,000 meters squared per gram. Okay, so you'll have to do a bit of unit conversion, but that's just gives you an idea of the order of magnitude of these adsorbents. So these are fairly typical middle-of-the-road values for the porosity, the density, and the pore diameter, and that gives you an idea of the order of area per gram of particle. Any questions on that so far? Okay, let's take a look then next here at some particular adsorbents. So here's activated alumina. It's got a fairly low surface area per unit mass, so it's on the order of 300 meters squared per gram. But it's one of the, there's four really heavily used adsorbents, and it's one of those four. Activated carbon is one of them, zeolites is another. And these pore diameters vary. So what you'll notice here is there's a range of pore diameters. We cannot say up front that this particle has a specific pore diameter. That pellet over here is we've pelletized this activated alumina so we can pack it into a column easily. But that just even one pellet will have a whole range of pore diameters if we look at the surface closely. So it just depends on how it was made. And this, because it's hydrophilic, it's certainly one of the most hydrophilic adsorbents. Its most common use is for dewatering, so removing moisture out of a stream of air. So the next widely used adsorbent is this one that's being passed around, the activated carbon. This is can be made from any carbonaceous source. Typically, we use coconut shells, nuts, wood, even sewage sludge can be used. And it's heated up to the right temperature to basically char the surface. And that heating process drives off a lot of the impurities. It creates a very, very porous solid that's remaining. So here's some microscope images where you can really look in and see that sort of that idea of a cylindrical pore there. And again, because these are made from natural materials, so coconuts, shells, nuts, and so forth, you're not going to get a single pore diameter value. You're going to get a range or pore diameter distribution. And so that varies between 10 and 50 angstroms. And the interesting thing about activated carbon is it's fairly hydrophobic, so it's not going to attach water. Okay, so where it is used, activated carbon, is it's going to attach organic molecules preferentially and let the water pass through. So this is a great way to separate organics from water. And the other interesting feature is it has a fairly low bonding strength. So whatever organic molecules attach to that surface, they don't bond very strongly. They just bond strong enough to be retained. But then we're going to see we can heat this up. We can pass steam through the system, heat it up, and that organic molecule will come back off again. So we can always recover our solutes later on, right? So we always have to think of the subsequent step. It's no good attaching your solutes to the solid phase and then you can't get it off there, right? So we always need to reverse that later on, and this one has good reversibility. And then the final major class of adsorbents are zeolites. So I've got several samples of zeolites here. Four samples are going to be passed around. This one here, it looks almost like cat litter. It's a natural zeolite from New Zealand. These are all from David Latulip's lab. Then these two bottles of green zeolites, this is the same zeolite, just in different particle size. So depending on how you'd like to use it, you can get it in a very fine powder form, or you can get it more in a granular form, which would be good for a packed bed. So these two green bottles. And then the final one is a synthetic zeolite. So this is a zeolite that's made in a lab. the natural zeolites that are being passed around here now, they take thousands of years to be formed. So up to about 50,000 years is the reaction time taken to form that zeolite. It's made from volcanic material and water react together, and given that long time frame, is those zeolites form. But a few decades ago, we figured out the formula for it and started to create synthetic zeolites. So here's zeolite 4A. The 4A means something very specific, which I'll explain in a minute. So as you pass those around, these zeolites all have a common structure. They always have an aluminum oxide and a silicon oxide. Okay, those are the parts that are present in the volcanic material. Then there's always a sodium, a potassium, or a calcium ion can be interchanged there. And what will happen is as we change these other molecules out, we get larger and larger zeolites forming. So essentially, the zeolite has this cage-like structure. So they're called molecular cages for that reason. Six windows, and these openings are circular or elliptical, depending on the particular atoms that are being used. And the interesting thing is there's a mathematical ratio between these subscripts here. So those numbers always have a mathematical consistency to them. There's a formula that can be used. And so what we discovered is a few decades ago, we could make these synthetically. Just following that same ratio, we can manufacture them. They have a fairly modest area per gram, so it's not a particularly high value there. That's not what we're interested in. What is really interesting about a zeolite is that cage opening is exact. There is no pore size distribution. All those zeolites in that bag have one number for the cage opening. Okay? So it's a very, very precise pore size. And that's why we use the zeolite, because when we know what's going in there, we can be guaranteed what's going to be retained inside that opening. So that's where the name molecular sieve comes from, because it has the sieving effect that smaller molecules can go inside there. Okay, now you've got to ask yourself, well, if a smaller molecule can go inside there, why doesn't it just leave again? Okay, why might that be?
Yeah. Are there different like groups on the outside versus the inside of the cage? So once it gets in, it gets like attracted to something that stays inside?
Right, there's a chemical attraction. So there's an electrostatic force that gets set up. Once that molecule enters into that cage, it's essentially trapped in there by electrostatic forces. Okay? It's not necessarily that, because if this opening here is 2.9 angstroms, so that's where the 2 comes from, 2.9 angstroms, it's not necessary that only particles of 2.9 angstroms and smaller can go in there. Okay? Actually, a particle that's just a little bit larger than 2.9 angstrom can actually wiggle its way through there. Given the kinetic energy of that molecule, it's bouncing around, so it can find a particular angle and still get into that opening, but then it's trapped once it's inside due to the electrostatic forces. And so reversing that reaction, again, requires adding heat to drive off that molecule and give it excitement and energy to get back out there again. Okay, so it's both a steric, a shape-based separation, so it's particles fit in there by a certain shape, and also it's a chemical bond, a chemical attraction, or electronegative attraction being formed. Now, we'll define these zeolites. So the synthetic zeolite being passed around, you see there on the bag is written zeolite 4A. It's that zeolite there. It refers to the window size on the zeolite. And so we can use that zeolite, we can buy that zeolite with fair confidence that it will be good for separating these particular molecules. Right? So we know what these molecules' shapes are, we can test these zeolites ahead of time, and then you can just purchase them out of a catalog. In fact, there's books and books of zeolites that describe what they're good for and from prior tests that have been done. Okay, So we can do that, and then here is just a general summary of the adsorbents that we've looked at. So the most common adsorbent by far is activated carbon. Now, granted, this data is extremely old, about 30 years, so I should get some more up-to-date information. Molecular sieves, silica gel, activated aluminum, but almost certainly you'll come across one of these. And then here's what I was referring to with a pore size distribution. We can use a sophisticated lab instrument. You can read up about this in the reference over here, in the CEDAR reference. Using helium and mercury porosimetry, we can actually determine what that pore size is and plot it against the cumulative pore volume per unit mass. And what we'll notice there is we'll get a distribution of pore diameters. So activated alumina, we get a range of pore diameters. Silica gel, activated carbon. But here's the interesting thing about zeolite. The zeolite 5A has a step function. So it's got no pores below that value, and all the pores beyond that 4.9 angstroms and above are the same size. Okay, so there's no distribution there. If you're wondering what MSC is, it's molecular sieve carbon, and it's made in two types of grades, and that's, again, another important adsorbent. MSC is very widely used for pressure swing adsorption, for nitrogen separation. Okay, any questions up to now for what we're dealing with? Okay, so let's just move on then. We looked at that application from Johannesburg last time. Here's a different one. Always really nice to go online and download some of these pictures, and you can see here molecular sieve adsorber. And this photo actually doesn't do it justice. There's a person standing over there. So you're getting an idea of scale of these beds. You may not particularly pick up on this right away, but this whole unit is built on a metal frame. And I was looking then at some other photos from this Flickr user, and then there's a later photo that shows this whole thing on a crane being picked up. It's going to be delivered. So it's a self-contained unit. It's very modular. So it's built on this skid for that reason. And there is a reason. These are usually oriented in a vertical way. Okay, so here it's on the skid, and it's probably oriented vertically for space reasons. But sometimes we also see these oriented vertically because we're going to trickle from the bottom up and use the bed from the bottom to the top. And you've got better control of that if you're trickling your liquid phase up from the bottom. Okay, so we'll typically use the bed from the bottom, fill it up. As it gets used up, once we notice at the top, we start to see our solute coming out at the top. So initially, once we start using the bed, we should see no solute leaving in the overflow in the top. As that bed gets used up, we'll start to detect solute leaving in the overhead. We'll stop, and we'll turn that bed off. And then we'll switch to using the second one. And while the second and the third one are being used, we regenerate the first one. Okay? So one is always in use, two of them are always in use, and one is being regenerated. Okay, so up to now, then, you might be asking yourself, well, why look at adsorption? Well, there's a number of good reasons. Firstly, it's at ambient temperatures. We don't need to put a lot of temperature into our system, which is going to be good if you're trying to separate something that would ordinarily require temperature. Now, not just high temperature, also think low temperatures, like cryogenic distillation, which we use for air nitrogen separation. That requires excessively low temperatures. So if we can adsorb, say, just nitrogen onto the adsorbent and let oxygen pass through, we can get some form of air separation that way. You'll use adsorption when you're trying to separate two components that have very close relative volatility. If you were looking at doing that same separation in a distillation column, you might have required a very large reflux ratio to get the right purity. Whereas the adsorbent won't have that energy requirement that comes with a large reflux ratio. Area is an important issue, and you can use membranes for separations. wherever you can use an adsorbent, you can typically consider a membrane alternative. And there's some interesting technology now where you combine the membranes and the adsorbents in the same unit. But essentially, if there's cases where your membrane area would be too large, then you might consider just the adsorbent process instead. Okay. And then this last one is feed is a very dilute stream of solute. So if you've got a very small amount of solute in your feed, that puts a large load on your process. If you're considering distillation, if you're considering a membrane, you've got that very high delta P that you need to push a lot of feed through your membrane that's got very little solute in it. Okay? But if you consider a packed bed, we don't mind putting lots of material through our packed bed, right? That bed is solid there, it's staying in its place, and if we're treating a very dilute stream or a very concentrated stream, it really doesn't matter. So adsorption has that particular advantage. The disadvantage is, of course, we're using only the surface of that adsorbance, and sometimes we can't penetrate all the way to the center. But that's we can easily fix that by using small particle sizes and pay a bit more for pressure drops. We can also have to recognize that we have to regenerate that MSA, so there's a cost for that. And then finally, we're going to see in the next slide, we have to move that MSA around sometimes, and so there's a finite lifetime. So you might see this word coming up when you talk about adsorbents, friability. It's a little bit of a strange word when you're talking about solids, but a solid that is friable means that it does not break down when it's being moved around mechanically. Okay, so we will take that activated carbon that's being passed around. You can put that through a centrifugal pump. You can put that through a cyclone. Okay, but what you don't want to have happen is that to break down into smaller and smaller particles, and then you just end up with a very fine mess that's hard to move. Okay, so a very friable MSA or adsorbent is robust to that mechanical stress. Okay, so I will come back to this one. I want to just get a little bit to some of the calculations here in theory. We'll come back to this next class. But what I want to look at here is we're going to look at the equilibrium idea now. So we're saying that we're going to take our adsorbent and put it in a container with the solute, and given enough time, we're going to get equilibrium happening. Okay, so here's my container. I'm going to look at this from a batch process initially, and then we'll look at it continuous later on. So this is my solid, my adsorbent. And inside this mixture, I have some solute. And that solute is present at a certain concentration. Okay, so we're going to, let's just get to this definition page, CA, the concentration of the solute A, and we're going to use kilograms of solute per meter cubed of fluid. Okay, so that fluid could be vapor phase or it could be liquid phase. So there's some solute in that system. On the adsorbent, we're going to get the solute moving onto the adsorbent. So some of the solute is going to penetrate inside here. CAS then is the amount that you adsorb onto the surface. And we'll use units there as shown, kilograms of solute per kilograms of adsorbent. Okay, so notice I'm using the word solute just as a way to distinguish and avoid confusion. But it's the same thing as adsorbate. So internal to this particle, you've got some small amounts of solutes that have penetrated through those pores and are locked inside them. And what we'll write then is an equation that relates those two concentrations. It's up there at the top. CAS is some equilibrium constant times CA. Okay. And so you can then back calculate what the units of K are in this instance. The units of K are the ratio of these units, CAS divided by CA. Okay, so just make sure that you're consistent with the units of K. Okay, and one thing to emphasize here is, especially for CAS, which is the ratio of two masses, kilograms of solutes per kilogram of adsorbent, when you write out the units, keep that other part there. Don't just write kilograms over kilograms. Write the whole word so that when you do unit cancellation in any calculations later on, you're canceling the correct kilograms. Now, we can also use this for gas phase systems. And for gas phase systems, you can rewrite that concentration in the vapor phase as a partial pressure. Okay, so CA, kilograms of adsorbate per meters cubed of fluid, you can use the ideal gas law, convert that to a partial pressure, and then your units of K will modify as well. So we'll just call that K dash if you're dealing with gas phase systems. In liquid phase systems, we'll just use K. Notice that CAS does not change. CAS is still, whether it's vapor phase around that solid or liquid phase around the solid, CAS's units are still how much mass of solute per kilogram of adsorbent. We don't work with partial pressures then in that case. Okay. So the implication of that mathematical equation is the following. It may not be obvious right there, but if you wanted to draw this as a graph, it says that CA and CAS are related to each other with a straight line of slope k. That makes some intuitive sense. It says that when you've got no solute present, zero solute present, you've got zero solute on your adsorbent. Okay? And depending on that slope, the steeper the slope, the more solute is going to load up onto the adsorbent. So k is an interesting value that we want to know about. And the comment down here is that few simples are this simple. What you will often find is in practice that the reality looks like this, because the black curve says that I can just give you a lot of solutes, so high concentrations of solute, and the solvent, sorry, I can give you high concentrations of solute, and the adsorbent will just keep taking it up, keep taking it up, keep taking it up, right? So this black curve really cannot go up to infinity, right? We know that there's a finite capacity on the adsorbent, okay? So that's an important word, capacity. How much material can you load up onto the adsorbent? We know that that's finite, and so this black curve can't just keep going up and up. Eventually, we have to drop off and reach some sort of maximum value that we can load up onto that surface. Okay, but if we're working down here in this region, that first equation up there might be perfectly valid for that purpose. Okay, now I'd like you to use that concept, because when we want to work with these systems, we have to figure out what K is. We don't know K, so we can go do a small experiment that will give us the value of K. And in fact, what's really interesting, you only need to do one experiment, okay, because there's only one number we need to find. So all we have to do is one experiment. Just over there, for example, we measure CA, we measure CAS, and I can draw a straight line through the origin and that point, and I get K. Right? So that's the minimum amount of work you can do if you know your system behaves in that way. So assuming that this linear isotherm holds. So this problem asks you to consider that. So we're dealing with a lab-based system where you go do such an experiment. Your experiment involves, you do a bench scale experiment with 1 liter of solution, and your solute is 0.05 grams per liter. Okay? So you put in 0.5 grams per liter and 3 grams of adsorbent. And you let it stand there and go to equilibrium, and you find that after some time, 96% of your contaminant was removed. Okay, so that's done in the lab. Then you get your K value, and then the question down here asks, well, let's go apply this to a bigger system. The bigger system is we've got 400 liters now that we need to treat of the same contaminant, 0.5 grams per liter. So you've got much more. The only difference is this time you want to remove 99% of that contaminant. Okay, so how much adsorbent do you need to do that? So I'm going to give you a minute to just work through the lab system. Work through the lab case. Let's forget about the larger scale step for now. Work through the lab case just to find capital K. I'll give you a small hint that you can use. So that green equation then is simply a mass balance. The solute that you start with must land up in one of two places. Either that solute is adsorbed onto the surface, or it remains in solution. Okay, so it doesn't go anywhere. So use that and to help you find capital K. So focus just on the lab part. We'll do the full scale part next. I'll give you another minute or so, and then we'll see if there's any answers from that. Anyone get some numbers for CAS, CA, or K even?
Yeah. I make no promises.
Go for it.
CAS to be 0.016.
Okay.
I got CA to be 0.002. And I got K to be 8.
CA was
0.002.
Okay, so we just need units for those, but we'll work through that in a minute. Okay.
Just a bunch of RAM.
Yeah. Okay, so those are the numbers there. Let's see how we can get there. The plan is, what's the first step? Before we even head to that final point, what would you start with first? Some people were like kind of pointing, TR. First step? No suggestion? Okay, let's use our mass balance. We've got this mass balance here. So we know the number on the left. Right, the solute that we're starting with is 0.05 grams. Okay, we've got 1 liter of solution, so at a concentration of 0.05 grams. And we know that solute adsorbed was 96% was adsorbed, and then that means that 4% must remain in solution. Okay, so 96% of 0.05 grams is 0.048. And then what's in solution is 0.002 grams. Okay, so your plan then, your first step, jumped a little ahead of myself here, was to use the mass balance. And then once we've used the mass balance, we can calculate CA and CAS. And once you have those two values, you can then get K as the ratio of them. Okay, so how did I find CA and CAS from the mass balance? Okay, in this case it's?
So it's 0.048 grams over 3 grams
of adsorbent. So here's where units start to become important. So let's put the units in. 3 grams of adsorbent were used and 0.04 grams of solute. Okay, so you can simplify that a little bit, and that's how Joseph got 0.016. So if you were looking at units here, grams of solute per gram of adsorbent. Okay, so that's CAS. CA. Well, it's our basis is 1 liter, so that's why that number matches this one down here. So our basis was 1 liter, so CA was equal to 0.0202 grams of solute per liter of fluid. Okay, we used 1 liter of fluid to begin with. Okay, so once we have those two, then we can go ahead and calculate K as CAS over CA. And in this instance, that's 0.016. And the units are liters per gram of solute. Okay, so just ensure that the units matter. So it's grams of solute, yeah.
Is that number 0.016 or is that supposed to be?
Oh, my mistake. Sorry, I was looking at half my calculation. Thank you. Thanks. Okay. Did I mess that up? It's absolutely right. I'm looking at totally the wrong part of my page. Thank you. So let's fix that right up. So K is 8 liters per grams of adsorbent. Thank you. Okay. Now, the key point for you to go ahead and try to get answers to point part 1 and part 2, because part 1 asks what is CA and CAS for the full-scale process. Okay, so we've really actually not even answered the question. The actual question asks, what is CAS and what is CA for the large scale process? Okay, so what we do know for that is we do know what K is. The K that we calculate from the lab is going to be the same K that we get at full scale, right? That we're using the same adsorbent, we're using the same solute system, so K has got to be the same. The only difference is, instead of being at this particular point on the curve, at the larger scale, we're going to be somewhere else on that line. Okay? But the same principle can be used. So here's the plan that you're going to go try. I'm not going to solve this for you. You've got the answers up there. The plan is that you're going to go use the K from the lab. You're going to use a mass balance, except this time it's 99% and 1%. So it's slightly different numbers over there. And you're going to use those to calculate CAS and CA. So I'm just going to write the values here for you. CAS is 0.004. And CA is 0.305. Okay, and they're in the same units as the prior answer. So I don't have space to write the units there. Okay, so use that to prove to yourself that K is that. And then the answer for the amount of adsorbent you need is 4.95 kilograms. So S. Okay, so I will show that part in the next class for you. But you should be able to reproduce those numbers. Okay, so just to wrap up then, the midterms are here at the front, and I will hand them out in alphabetical order. The other thing is that I will cancel class on Tuesday to give you some time to work on your projects and finalize those up. So no class on Tuesday, and then we'll resume class on Wednesday again.